A very good evening, all of you. I know it is hard to be to keep yourselves awake by the end of this day, but I'll try my level best to keep you awake because I'm going to tell you about new things which can prevent cancer. I'm going to talk about the integration of complementary and alternative medicine in cancer treatment. So basically, complementary and alternative medicine, it is a group of diverse medical and healthcare system practices and products that are not generally considered a part of the conventional medicine. CAM therapies focus on what comprises the health, cause illness, and promotes emotional, physical, and spiritual well-being. Complementary and alternative medicine, they are often used to acknowledge the blending of those non-traditional treatment modalities with the conventional views and therapeutic approaches. Now coming to the integrative therapy. Integrative therapy is a term used as a combined offering of conventional and complementary therapies to stimulate the body's natural healing process. It emphasizes the use of unconventional treatments as an adjunct to conventional medicine. So most of the time you will see that those complementary therapies are those therapies which are used as an adjunct with the conventional treatment, and alternative therapies are those therapies which are chosen as an alternative with the alternative to the conventional medicine. Integrative therapy is also an holistic approach which attempts to meet a patient's unique and individualized needs for healing. Every patient is an individual person, and every person responds to the treatment in a different manner. So whenever any complementary or any integrative therapy is being planned, you have to see that you are providing an individualized thing to the patient. Why there's an increasing use of complementary and alternative medicine? Because there's an enormous increase in the public access to the worldwide information. Everybody has an access to all kinds of information. Then there is an escalating cost of the modern allopathic medical care. Then there is an affinity for an holistic or natural approach to healing. Everybody expects a holistic approach for their treatment. Then there are so many side effects of the conventional treatment which are going on. So to manage those side effects, complementary and alternative medicine is being used. Then dissatisfaction with the mindset of the physician, and then the overall failure of conventional therapies to meet the overall needs of the patient. Then there are various types of complementary and alternative medicines. They can be either natural products, or they can be mind-body medicine, or manipulative and body-based practices. What are the natural products? This area of complementary and alternative medicine includes use of variety of herbal medicines, which are also known as botanicals, and they can be in the form of vitamins, minerals, and other natural products. And many of these natural products, they are even sold over the counter as dietary supplements. Then the next type is mind-body medicine. Mind-body practices focus on the interactions among the brain, mind, body, and behavior with the intent to use the mind to affect the physical functioning and promote health. And this includes meditation, acupuncture, acupressure, etc. Then comes manipulative and body-based practices. These practices focus primarily on the structures and systems of the body, including the bones and joints, soft tissues, and circulatory lymphatic systems, for example, massage therapy and spinal manipulation. Coming to the safety concerns related to these complementary and alternative medicines, it is said that most of the complementary and alternative medicines, they have an independent association with worse quality of life and shorter survival. Like most of the conventional treatments, if the patient is on any conventional treatment, the person is going to have a poor quality of life. But if they have accepted or taken up any complementary therapy, then there are chances for the improvement of quality of life. Then there is also an antioxidant interference with chemotherapy and radiation. Because of the oxidative damage to the cells, it may increase the risk of cancer. The use of antioxidant herbs and vitamins have been proposed for cancer treatment, and an antioxidant may interfere with the radiation therapy and some chemotherapy agents as well. Then there are sometimes so many drug interactions. Whenever a patient is on any chemotherapy drugs, and if a patient is on taking any vitamin or mineral supplements, then there can be a drug interaction with the chemotherapy drugs. So whenever these complementary and alternative, these complementary therapies are being prescribed, you need to be aware of these interactions also. Then bleeding. Multiple herbs and supplements carry an increased risk of bleeding. So all these needs to be taken on very cautiously. Then phytoestrogens, they are the plant-based compounds structurally similar to estradiol, capable of binding to estrogen receptors as agonist or antagonist. Then hepatotoxicity, multiple herbs and supplements also may cause hepatotoxicity. Then standardization, these preparation of the complementary drugs, it may vary from manufacturer to manufacturer and even with batch to batch. So if they are not standardized in their manufacturing, they should be used with cautious. Then there are some therapies which are used for cancer treatment and secondary prevention. There is a maize stick, mushroom and beta glucans. This has been associated with tumor regression in greater than 50% of the patients with stage 2 and stage 4 of breast, lung and liver cancer, whereas no improvement has been seen in patients with leukemia, gastric or brain cancer. Then shiitake mushroom extract. It has been observed that cellular immunity potentiation and tumor growth inhibition has been observed with this. Then soy, there is a strong evidence that has been shown which supports the benefits of soy for cholesterol reduction. As a source for dietary protein, there is a good evidence for alleviation of menopausal hot flashes on or for diarrhea in young children and infants. Then there is a chaparral tree tea. This tea also has antioxidant properties. If we look at the chemotherapy toxicities, there's a coenzyme has been studied for prevention of anthracycline cardiotoxicity. Then vitamin E has been observed for prevention of cisplatin neuropathy. Then cachexia, no complementary and alternative medicine therapy has been demonstrated as beneficial for weight loss, wasting or appetite suppression associated with malignancy. Nausea and vomiting. Use of ginger and if acupuncture also can be done on wrist has been proved to be helpful in treating chemotherapy induced nausea and vomiting. Other complementary and alternative medicine approaches are black tea, clove and lavender. There has been a study done by Anu K in 2008 in our center in which it was shown that she had given a ginger powder to those patients to see the effect on nausea and vomiting during chemotherapy. So it was found that ginger powder was significantly effective in reducing the severity of both chemotherapy-induced delayed nausea and delayed vomiting. And chemotherapy-induced toxic symptoms like abdominal pain and constipation were also found to be less amongst the experimental group. Then the constipation. Numerous natural derivatives are also used for constipation, for example, aloe vera, psyllium. Radiotherapy, there have been adverse effects of radiotherapy and how these adverse effects can be taken care of by Panax, ginseng, ozone therapy or Reiki. They have been useful for the treatment of radiation adverse effects. Then saliva, miltirosia has been used in the case of radiation induced pneumonitis. Then chamomile and aloe vera for skin problems due to radiation. There's another study done by Jisha George in 2009 in our center. It has in this also aloe vera was used in head and neck cancer patients after radiation after their radiation therapy. So in this also it was found that aloe vera is not effective in preventing radiotherapy induced skin reaction, but it was effective in delaying the onset as well as reducing the severity of the radiotherapy induced skin reaction in head and neck cancer patients. It was also seen that aloe vera significantly reduced the pain associated with radiotherapy induced skin reaction during the later period of radiotherapy during the 6th and 7th week. Then there are some therapies used for primary cancer prevention which include lycopene. It is a carotenoid and has an antioxidant and anti-proliferative properties. Selenium. This selenium is under controversy. Many studies have shown that it reduces the risk for developing prostate cancer if it is used independently. But I've gone through many other studies which have also shown that selenium, if it is used in combination with vitamin E, then it is more beneficial if rather than being used independently. Then green tea, it is produced from the dried leaves of Camellia sinensis, and it also decreases the risk for cancer. Vitamin A. Vitamin A is composed of retinol and carotenoid precursors, and all trans retinoic acid is found beneficial in patients with APL and has antioxidant properties. Vitamin C. Evidences have proved that the correlation between high vitamin C intake and reduced risk of cancer. Vitamin E also has antioxidant properties, and it has proved to reduce the risk for breast, lung and prostate cancer. There are many other therapies, other complementary therapies which can be used, like there can be music therapy, there can be biofeedback, there can be, so I've not touched all these therapies, but I'll just like to touch upon the, what is healing touch? Healing touch is a therapeutic approach to wellness that addresses physical, mental, emotional and spiritual health, and it is a true holistic approach to health. Healing touch has been used in wound healing, pain management, stress management, prevention of illness, enhancement of spiritual development, and support and assistance in the dying process. So healing touch is appropriate for all ages and states of health and or illness. So to conclude, I will say that hope is unique with each individual as a fingerprint, and each individual has the right to be told about all the options and decide for themselves. Thank you.